Good morning and welcome. We're glad to have all of you with us that braved the snow and the cold this morning. Whether you're here in person or online, it's a blessing to have you with us. And we want to wish you a happy Valentine's Day. And there was a love, you all have your own love story, but there was definitely a love story that surpassed all. And that was Jesus, who said, "You are beautiful, you are precious, and you are loved by me." And I think that's our greatest love story of all for all of us. So would you please stand and join us?
There's no greater love than Jesus. There's no greater love than he gives. There's no greater love that frees us so deep within. Jesus, there's no greater love than he gives. There's no greater love that frees us so deep within. All the world's empty pleasures will soon pass away, but his love will last forever. In my heart it shall remain. There's no greater love than Jesus. There's no greater love than he gives. There's no greater love that frees us so deep within. We praise your name, stand in awe of your never-ending love, love so great that it comes. There's no greater love than he gives. There's no greater love that frees us so deep within. There's no greater love than Jesus. There's no greater love than he gives. There's no greater love that frees us so deep within.
Dear friends, let us love one another, for love comes from God. Everyone who loves has been born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love.
This is how God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. This is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins.
Spoken mercy over me. To the
heart will be open to be able to receive the message that you have already laid on Terry's heart. And I pray, Father, that your Holy Spirit would just speak to him. And I pray that every person here would be brave enough to just surrender and allow you to penetrate their hearts and their lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Welcome to worship at 4th and Mill, Beloit First Christian Church, on this chilly morning. And also, happy Valentine's Day. We're glad you're here. We welcome those who are joining us here in person to worship, as well as those who are worshiping online. The worship program is an excellent resource to help you find out what's happening at Beloit First Christian Church. And we also encourage you, if you're present today, to check at the Welcome Center. A person there will be able to answer questions and provide more information on a variety of things that we hope will be helpful to you. We also want to encourage you, if you're here or online, to check out our church website at www.beloitfcc.org. That has excellent information on the activities of the church and more resources for your information. I want to highlight just a few items from inside the worship program. Previously, we had planned to restart Kids Sunday School today, but because of the weather forecast and concerns that were expressed about the extreme weather, we postponed the restart of Kids Sunday School to next Sunday, February 21st. We still will restart. It's just going to be next week instead of today. And we do want to remind you that we do have child care available now during the 10:30 a.m. worship time, and we thank you for the volunteers that are making that possible. We hope that will be helpful to families with young children. Have another event that's not in the worship program that we need to tell you about. We've heard about Men's Encounter recently. A Women's Encounter event will be happening in Salina on Friday, Saturday, and Sunday, March 5th, 6th, and 7th of 2021. And Rachel Ducote is the contact person for more information on that. Scholarships are available to make the event more possible if cost is an issue. So check with Rachel Ducote if you would like information on that. On the inside of the back page of your worship program is an update on the kids ministry. Two different things. Clash continues on Wednesday, February 17th, in their continuing study on the non-Avengers. And also on Wednesday is a fusion program described as Stretch. You can read more about that in the worship program. There's also a response card that tears off on the back page of your worship program if you'd like to turn in information to the church or have a request for information. And the back side of it has an opportunity for a prayer, concern, or joy if you want to share that with the church family. Now I need to switch gears for our prayer meditation. I remember a time when I was a student in college at the University of Illinois, and I was fearful and uncertain about what the future would hold and many questions about my life. I just didn't know how it was going to turn out, and the fear caused me to anticipate the worst possible option for all these unknown things. The fear caused me to feel anxious, restless, and intimidated. For our prayer meditation today, I want to share a verse that God used in my life to help me with that. It talks about the God who delivers us from our fears when we pray. I invite you to listen as I read Psalm 34, verses 4 and 5, which says, I sought the Lord, and he answered me, and he delivered me from all my fears. Those who look to him are radiant, and their faces are never covered with shame. What can we learn from these words from Psalm 34? In this passage, the psalmist clarifies some truths about God, and he said he sought the Lord, he prayed to God, and God did several things. First, he answered me. Second, he delivered me. Third, he made me radiant. Fourth, he never let my face be covered with shame. I can testify that God did that in my life when I was facing a time of uncertainty and questions and frustration, and he can do it for us as we look to him too. These spiritual truths about God should inspire our prayers to the Lord as a church family. We already have prayer joys and concerns that we've shared in our earlier worship service that we'll include in our prayer time during this service. We do have some items that have been passed on by text and email and online communication. We appreciate all those, but we welcome the things that you would share right now, not only joys and concerns, but especially testimonies about what God is doing in and through your life and the lives of other people. Whatever's on your heart, we want to share together as a church family about those things. What would you share as a prayer, joy, concern, or testimony? We welcome the things that are on your heart. Dina Budke is asking for prayers for a friend that was diagnosed with cancer. Thank you for sharing that. We'll also pray for Doug Betts, as he's not feeling well today. We hope he's just kind of overloaded, but not sure what the case is that's causing him not to feel well. I'm going to lead us in prayer in just a minute. Yes. We're glad to know that you're making it well. We'll continue to pray for God's touch on your life. I'm going to lead us in prayer in just a minute. I see a hand back there. Okay, I'm sorry to hear that, Chris. We'll pray for your oldest daughter who has a cancer diagnosis. Thank you for sharing that. I'm going to lead us in prayer in just a minute with a pattern of prayer following the letters of the word pray, P-R-A-Y, in which each of those different letters represents a different type or family of prayer. P represents praise, R represents repent, A represents ask, and Y represents yield. I'm going to offer suggestions as we're praying, but I want to encourage you to pray on your own in your own heart, however God prompts you. Praise. As we begin our prayers, I invite you to express your own praise and devotion to God in your own heart, however he prompts you. We do praise you, God, as we acknowledge that you are the only creator, sustainer, and giver of life. Thank you for the truth from your Bible that tells us that you are all-present, all-knowing, and all-powerful. There's none other like you. We praise you as God Almighty, as the loving, sovereign, Holy One. You alone are eternal, everlasting, and exalted. We praise you with our lives. We lift our hands in your name, and we praise your holy name. Repent. As we continue on our prayers, I invite you to talk to God in your own heart about your own life, however he prompts you. We pray observing the pattern in Isaiah 1:18, where the truth there says, "Come now, let us settle the matter, says the Lord. Though your sins are like scarlet, though they are white as snow, they will be white as snow. Though they are red as crimson, they shall be like wool." We need that truth and promise. I need that promise. Therefore, God, I confess my own personal sin. I repent, and I seek your mercy, washing, and cleansing. It's only by the blood of Jesus that we have any hope of forgiveness and cleansing. We don't deserve it. We can't earn it. We can't pay it back. It's just by grace, just as we receive it as a gift. It's the only way we can be right with you. Ask. As we continue on our prayers, I invite you to talk to God in your own heart, asking him whatever he prompts you to pray about. Thank you for allowing us to share in this journey together in our spiritual journey as a church family. Thank you that we can encourage and lift one another up and support one another on the journey. And thank you for each individual, because each one is valuable and significant and important, created in your image. We give you thanks for the three Fusion men who were baptized this last Wednesday in obedience of faith, Alex Hernandez, Asa Carr, and Dylan Brummer. Be with them in their spiritual journey and help them, we pray. We lift them before your throne. Give you praise along with Joni Adams and others who have testified to the meaningful benefit of the Vertical Marriage Conference yesterday. We thank you for many folks who were able to participate, for the seeds of truth that were planted, and for the transformation that has begun to make a difference in the lives of individuals and couples. We just commit that whole situation to you and thank you. We give you thanks along with Kendra for your work in her life. That it's been 6 months since she's had a seizure. We thank you for the progress you're providing in her healing and recovery. We pray for wisdom on ongoing medical considerations. Be with her, we pray. We lift her before the throne. We give you praise for the President's Day holiday coming up tomorrow, February 15th. We pray you would be with us as a country as we reflect on the leaders you've given us as a country and give you thanks. We pray with Mary Lou Heller for her sister Martha, as she has breast cancer and the chemo is making her weak and sick. Help her, we pray. We pray thanking you for the medical treatment, but we pray that you would protect her from the weakness and sickness. Pray along with Dina for a friend who's diagnosed with cancer. Help that person, we pray. Pray along with Chris Jones for his oldest daughter who's received a cancer diagnosis. Help her, we pray. We pray for Doug Betts as he's not feeling well. Touch him, we pray. We pray along with Bruce Wright for his brother Brian, who's in the hospital and needs your touch for healing. We pray along with Susan Graybon for the deliverance from the effects of cold, as she said her family and others she knows are challenged and struggling with the ongoing cold that has been so difficult. We pray along with Donna Muncy for her son-in-law Brad in Kansas City, as he's seeking medical diagnosis, may possibly have leukemia or some other medical concern, and pray for wisdom for the doctors to help and for your protection and provision. We pray for Tom Lawson as he recovers after back surgery in Salina on Friday. Help him, we pray. We pray along with Lori Dahl for Logan Buttenhoff as he's scheduled for gallbladder surgery tomorrow, February 15th at Salina Hospital. We pray with Sherry Angel for her son-in-law, Matt Fuller, as he'll have surgery February 18th. We continue to pray with Tiffany Bachover for her mom, Anna Sears Jones, as she recovers at home after heart surgery recently in Wichita. We pray with Sharon Keister for friends of Allison and Matt Smith. Their friend Jen Mayfield is starting chemo, and will have breast cancer surgery in the future after the birth of the child she's carrying. It's a very complicated, complex situation. We pray for your touch and your help. We pray along with Will Hutchie for his brother Richard, who continues to decline in a Lincoln, Nebraska hospital, in an ICU room battling COVID. He's had ups and downs, and we just thank you that you've protected and kept him with us. We pray for his deliverance and healing, and we just trust him to your guidance and provision. We pray for the kids' Sunday school program that's postponed until next Sunday, February 24th. We pray for Ron Pontier as he has ongoing preventative chemo treatments that have been hard, but we pray for your protection and your presence with him. We pray for our government and all elected officials, from the president at the federal level down to the state level and local level, for all of them to have wisdom and safety and protection for all the considerations that are before them. We lift before you Terry Schamburg And we pray for him as he'll be sharing your word, teaching and expounding on the word of God. We pray that you would fill him, anoint him, use him, allow him to be a channel of your truth, and that you would prompt your spirit to be present to prompt our hearts to know how to apply and interpret and personally make a difference in our lives because of the truth of your word that Terry will be sharing. We want to pray for the families of those who have experienced the passing of loved ones. We pray for the family of Karen Stort's sister, Audrey, who passed away in Oklahoma. Send comfort and peace. We pray for the family of Thomas Colby as his memorial service was Friday. We pray for the family of Brian and Chandra Mettler's daughter, Tasha, as she passed away from a vehicle crash recently. We pray for the family of Jessica Lowry's mom, Deborah Curlow, as she passed away, and her memorial service will be February 19th. We pray along with Sharon Keister for the dad of a family friend by the name of Marla, as the dad passed away February 13th in Colorado. Send comfort and peace. And we pray for the family of Etta Bauch's brother, Darwin Dietz, who died. And for each of these families, send comfort and peace. And be with us to be your hands, your feet, your words, to reach out to support and encourage those who have experienced loss. Yield. As we continue on in our prayers, I invite you to talk to God in your own heart, yielding to him however he prompts you. Lord, I surrender to you all my fears. I do not know what the future holds, and I'm not in control of my future. I praise you according to the truth from Psalm 34, which says, I sought the Lord, and he answered me, and he delivered me from all my fears. Those who look to him are radiant. Their faces are never covered with shame. I acknowledge that truth has come to pass in my life when I've prayed, and you have answered, and you have delivered me. You provide direction and protection and guidance for me. And so now I yield again as I trust you, cling to you, rely upon you, and surrender to you in every way, as I shared in the vertical marriage conference yesterday. I'm all in. I'm totally and completely committed to you, Lord, and I ask you to take me and use me for whatever is your pleasure. I pray all these things in the blessed name of Jesus, our risen Lord, Master, and Savior. Amen.
Morning, everyone. Welcome to everyone here and those that are online with us. This is our communion time. We invite all that have accepted Jesus as Lord and Savior to take communion with us. Those that are at home, please have your elements handy, and those that are here can come forward after I pray. Take as much time as you need. Just a reminder, the offering boxes are by the sanctuary doors. If you're online with us, you can give at BeloitFCC.org or mail to 321 North Mill, Beloit. And we want to bless those gifts and the giver. The praise team, as we take our communion this morning, will sing At the Cross, and What a Beautiful Song. The author writes these words, O Lord, you've searched me. You know my way. Even when I fail you, I know you love me. At the cross, I bow my knee, where your blood was shed for me. There's no greater love than this. You have overcome the grave. Those are beautiful lyrics for us to meditate on this morning that offer us so much hope as we remember that Jesus died for our salvation. Let us pray. Deacons, you may come forward. Lord, thank you for this communion. Thank you, Lord, for sending your Son, for covering our sin, for your forgiveness and your grace, so we could have eternal life. Let us never forget the great price Jesus paid. We remember him now as we examine our hearts, humble ourselves and acknowledge our need for you. In Jesus' name, amen.
And when Good morning. Get my stuff together here. I guess I thank you, worship team. During the earlier segment there when you were singing your songs, I just pretty much closed my eyes, and it was just like almost a heavenly chorus, you know. It was just super. I just really just enjoyed that. Well, on this cold snow, well, not so much snowy, I guess. Yesterday it was snowy when we came for the marriage conference, but today it's just cold. So, I guess I just want to start by saying that I want to speak to you from my heart this morning. I just feel like there's some things that the Lord is graciously allowing me to share with you, and I just also want you to know that I'm really humbled to be able to declare God's word. It is so valuable and so precious, and I'm just honored to be able to stand behind this pulpit and speak his word. I don't take it lightly, and I realize the responsibility that comes with standing behind a pulpit, and that we're responsible to handle the Word of God very accurately, and I do my best to do that. I think sometimes we make the gospel message too complicated, too difficult, and really it's just believe in your heart that Jesus is Lord and profess with your mouth that he is and be saved. And that's really the message of the cross, and it's what we are commissioned to proclaim to the world. There are always two objectives that I have when I'm given the opportunity to speak, and I think that this is the way messages, at least from my perspective, should always include. And that's, one, it's always encouragement, because I think we need to be encouraged by the Word, because there is so much stuff out there to discourage us that we need to be encouraged, and we need to be, and the other thing is we need to be challenged by the Word. The Word does challenge us, and I think that we should desire for the Word to challenge us, Lord, to want to be transformed. And so anyway, between services I was kind of went away to just kind of pray a little bit, and I didn't share this in the first one, but I just feel like the Lord is wanting me to just read this to you here. And it's about Elijah, and he says, "So he said, go forth and stand on the mountain before the Lord. And behold, the Lord was passing by, and a great and strong wind was rending the mountains and breaking in pieces the rocks before the Lord. But the Lord was not in the wind. And after the wind, an earthquake. But the Lord was not in the earthquake. And after the earthquake, a fire. But the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire, the sound of a gentle blowing." I think sometimes we always look for the dramatic. We look for, you know, the big event, you know, and God's, you know, blowing and speaking to us. But oftentimes we find that he whispers to us. And I just felt like that was what that he was wanting me to say, is that we need to just be still and listen to that still, quiet voice just gently whispering into our heart this morning. Let me just pray here before we start. Lord, help us to be still and recognize that you are God. Lord, that you would gently whisper into our hearts this morning as we come before you. And God, we love you. And help us not to be fearful when there's a quiet moment, but just to realize that you can speak to us in those times. We just adore you, Lord. We worship you. We give you praise. We give you glory. We give you honor, for truly you're worthy of it all. Help me, Lord, to convey what you've put on my heart. And Lord, we ask, and I've been asking and praying, that you would make hearts receptive to your word, that you would halt our hearts, halt the busy distractions in our minds that are oftentimes disturbing and preventing us from hearing what you want to speak into our lives, Lord. And I just give you all the praise. We ask this in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Well, I guess this morning I want to start. This is so strange to me, you know, because I've spoke some through the years, but not very often do I ever repeat the message, you know, like an hour later or something. You know, it's like, okay, well, yeah. I mean, and I don't want it to really be the same message. I want it to be specifically for this group of people here, because God speaks to us wherever we're at. In whatever place you're at here this morning, God wants to meet you right there. He wants to speak life into your heart. And so, I will begin, and this will kind of set the stage, or at least help you to determine, you know, really kind of what's on my heart and where we're headed this morning. So I want to read this to you. It's something I wrote maybe a couple weeks ago. We are living in unprecedented times. There is much confusion, much division, and yes, even much anger. Our nation has seemingly been turned upside down. It appears to have happened suddenly, but the reality is it has been happening for years. We as a nation have said to God, we don't want you in our lives, not in our schools, not in our public buildings, not in our government, not in our highest courts in the land. As a result, we have redefined the institution of marriage that God Himself, the Creator of all, established between one man and one woman. We have a gender identity crisis. And worst of all, we have devalued human life that God instituted and brought into existence by killing millions of innocent babies. The church in America is now under attack. The freedom to meet and worship is a target. Free speech is being threatened. The term cancer culture is now part of our vocabulary. Whether we like to admit it or not, the church is in part responsible for where we are at. We have been guilty of conforming to the world rather than radically changing the world with the gospel of Jesus Christ. We have allowed the things of this world to have a greater influence on the way we live our lives than Christ Himself. We have gone astray and served other gods. We are guilty of half-hearted Christianity, lukewarmness, which God Himself says in the book of Revelations, I wish you were either hot or cold, but because you are lukewarm, I will spit you out of my mouth. We will never Whenever we place anything or anyone before or above God, we have opened the door to deception. Whenever we allow any desire to rival God's proper place, we have taken the first step to moral and spiritual decay. We will never legislate morality until, as a nation, once again we encounter the living God who is able to make all things new. This is not about Republicans or Democrats. It is a spiritual battle. We are fighting good versus evil, light versus darkness, goodness versus godlessness. People are all over the nation are praying and interceding for God to use this time in our nation to awaken the church from its slumber. The Bible clearly teaches when we have gone astray, the first step back is repentance. It is always appropriate to allow God to examine our heart, to see if there is anything in us that displeases Him and prevents us from living out our God-given purpose and destiny. That purpose being to reflect the image of the One who created us and to live our life for Him. To love God with all our heart, soul, and mind. To love, serve, and disciple people. All God ever wants is our heart. Because if He has our heart, He has all of us. If He has all of our heart, then the choices and decisions we make in this life will bring glory and honor to Him. Several weeks ago, when Pastor Cliff approached me after a Sunday morning service and asked me if I would be willing to speak while he was gone, and I don't know how long it was. It was for sure probably at least 6 weeks ago and maybe eight. But that night, even as I went home and went to bed, I was awakened about 2 a.m, and which is not unusual for me to wake up, but I knew instantly when I woke up that it was just God wanting to speak to me, and so I got up and grabbed my Bible and went downstairs, and he took me to this passage. In Hebrews 3, and let me just kind of set the stage here for this. This is about what prevented the Israelites from entering into the promised land. And so it's Hebrews 3, 12, and 13. And it says, take care, brethren, that there not be any of you an evil, unbelieving heart that falls away from the living God. But encourage one another day after day, as long as it is still called today, so that none of you will be hardened by the deceitfulness of sin. And I thought about that, and the first thing that kind of jumped out at me was, I think what an unbelieving heart is, but this says here, an evil, unbelieving heart. And, you know, my concept of evil is something really bad, I mean, really dark, kind of wicked, almost demonic, you know, when we think of something evil. And so I did a little cross-referencing, and I came to Mark 7, 20 and 23, and this is what it says. And he was saying, that which proceeds out of the man, that is what defiles the man. For from within, out of the heart of man, proceed the evil thoughts, fornications, thefts, murders, adulteries, deeds of coveting, and wickedness, as well as deceit, sensuality, envy, slander, pride, and foolishness. All these evil things proceed from within and defile the man. And I thought about that, and I'm thinking, that describes me and my heart. And that's what God considers evil. And so, it's like God's definition of evil and ours is not the same. And so, so I just felt like this morning that God was asking us to just allow the living word to kind of examine our hearts to see where they're at. Is there, if there's anything in our hearts that prevent us from really serving him to the fullest. And so I want to begin by just looking at some different scriptures concerning the heart. Jeremiah 17:9 says, "The heart is more deceitful than all else and is desperately sick." Proverbs 4:23, "Watch out over your heart with all diligence, for from it flow the springs of life." In Proverbs 23:7, "As a man thinketh in his heart, so is he." Now, if we go back to Hebrews, and I'm not reading the whole thing because it's fairly long and time is a factor. So, but if we go into the fourth chapter, then down to verse 7, it says, "For the word of God is living and active, sharper than a two-edged sword, and piercing as far as division of soul and spirit, of both joints and marrow, and able to judge the thoughts and intentions of the heart." And you know, I've read that passage of scripture, I wouldn't know how many times, that particular verse. I mean, it's a pretty well-known verse. And but I always kind of saw it, or I concentrated maybe overly so on, you know, this double-edged sword going into our innermost being, you know, and down into the dark places and the crevices and exposing things to us. And kind of revealing to us areas of our life that might not be pleasing. But I was struck by the last part of it, and able to judge the thoughts and intentions of the heart. God is able to judge even our intentions, what are the intent of our heart is. And so I thought this morning that we would just once again just kind of examine our heart through the word. And it says in Psalms, and this is a couple of David's Psalms, "Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my anxious thoughts, and see if there be any hurtful way in me, and lead me in the everlasting way." And then again in Psalms 26:2, "Examine me, O Lord, and try me, and test my mind and my heart." So I thought that it might be good to look at King David, because the Bible says this about King David. "He raised up David to be their king, concerning whom he also testified and said, I have found David, the son of Jesse, a man after my heart, who will do all my will." And I'm thinking, okay, well, that's who we need to look at then. And then I also thought, though, well, wait a minute. Was David really a man after God's own heart? I mean, he was not always good. I mean, he was an adulterer. He was a murderer. He was a liar. And yet God called him and said that he was a man after his own heart. And what characteristics and qualities did he have that caused God to say that about him? But I also think that also gives us hope, you know, that there's evil, wicked things in our heart, and yet It doesn't disqualify us to be used of God and to be called a person after God's own heart. Because, you know, people sometimes say to me, you know, when I'm talking to them, it's like, well, you don't know what I've done. And I don't. But I know now that I can say, well, you don't know what David did. So, you know, we're never beyond. As long as there is breath in our life, we are fully able to be transformed and changed into the likeness and image of God. But anyway, in Samuel then, let me just go through some scriptures here referring to that. And it says, the Lord said to Samuel, fill your horn with oil and go. I will send you to Jesse the Bethlehemite, for I have selected a king for myself among his sons. And then, well, so he went to Jesse's house, and Jesse had eight sons, and he paraded seven of them before him. And, you know, the first one was his oldest son, you know, big kind of stout guy, you know, I'm sure that Samuel was thinking, well, this is probably the one that he's going to anoint. But he said no. And every one, seven, no. And then he said, are these all your children? And he says, and Jesse said, well, there remains yet the youngest, and behold, he is tending sheep. Then Samuel said to Jesse, send and bring him, for we will not sit down until he comes here. And so he came, and so he sent and brought him in, and now he was ruddy with beautiful eyes and a handsome appearance. And the Lord said, arise, anoint him, for this is he. Then Samuel took the horn of oil and anointed him in the midst of his brothers, and the Spirit of the Lord came mightily upon David from that day forward. So there we see that he was anointed to be king. Now, it was some time before he actually became king. But what were some of the qualities that David possessed that he was called a man after God's own heart? Well, for one thing, he was quick to repent when he had sinned. And, you know, Psalm 51 is a very familiar psalm that David wrote, and he wrote this right after he'd been unfaithful or had sinned with Bathsheba. And so we see in that, and as you read that, you can tell that he's sincere, that he just pouring his heart out before God, and that he is truly grieved that he sinned against God. And he says this, be gracious to me, O Lord, according to your loving kindness. According to the greatness of your compassion, blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions, and my sin is ever before me. Against you, you only, I have sinned and done what is evil in your sight, so that you are justified when you speak and blameless when you judge. You know, the thing that stands out to that is this comment. It says, and against you, you only, I have sinned. I think sometimes sin, you know, it may involve other people, and we may actually be sinning against the people or against a person, but ultimately it is a sin against God. And David recognized that he had sinned against a holy God, and he was truly repentant of that. So I think that's one quality that David had, that he was called a man after God's own heart. The second thing was David was a worshiper. He wrote over half the Psalms in the Bible that we have. When he got the news that his son had died, as recorded in 2 Samuel 12, the scripture says that he went into the house of the Lord and worshiped. So, you know, he got the news that his son was dead. And by the way, it was the son that Bathsheba had that he fathered. And, you know, I said this in the early service, and I'll say it again, you know, we can be forgiven of anything, but there may be consequences for the sin that we have committed. And I, you know, for instance, I mean, you can go murder someone and be in prison and ask God to forgive you and invite him into your life. You receive Christ, you're born again, you're a new person in Christ, but that doesn't mean that you're still not going to have to pay the penalty for your sin. And so he was a true worshiper. And to be a true worshiper requires spending time with God and lingering with him. And I've heard of a comment not long ago that has a lot of significance. And it says, learn to linger, and then eventually you will love to linger in God's presence. And so that is, so true. A true worshiper has a love for God and a desire to be with him. And what, you know, this is Valentine's Day, the you know, we celebrate love, and all of us have, well, not all of us, but some of us have experienced love. And, well, we've all experienced love. I'm not sure what I'm trying to say. let me start over here. We have all experienced love. That love is from God, period. Not all of us have experienced falling in love with someone else. I mean, but that's kind of what it is with a love relationship with the Lord. Is like when you're in love, you want to be with them. You want to spend time with them. And so that was the case with David, is that he loved to be in God's presence, which kind of overlaps with the third characteristic of God, of David. David valued the presence of God in his life. He cherished that presence more than life itself. And it says in Psalm 51, again, going back to that, Psalm 51, his prayer of repentance, and when he just pours his heart out to God, it says, do not cast me away from your presence, and do not take your Holy Spirit from me. He saw the value in God's presence in his life. And, you know, in the Old Testament, there wasn't the indwelling of the Holy Spirit like there is now. But God's presence was there. Well, like in the Israelites, when they were wandering in the desert, there was a pillar of clouds in the day and a pillar of fire at night, and that was God's presence. He was present with them. And in fact, Moses had a conversation with God, and he said this, do not lead us from here. This is Moses talking. If your presence doesn't go with us. And it is not by your going with us so that I and your people may be distinguished from all the other peoples who are upon the face of the earth. Moses recognized the value of God's presence in their life, and he said, don't send us from here if your presence isn't going to go with us. And I think that that's one of the greatest things that we have, is his presence in our life. Do you realize this? Have you ever stopped to think about this, that the very presence that raised Christ from the dead, that healed the lame, made the blind to see, turned the water into wine, is the very same presence that abides in you and me, if you've received Christ. He said, it's important that I go away, because if I don't go away, the Comforter can't come. And so he sent the Holy Spirit to dwell in the life of a believer. And that's what separates us and distinguishes you and I from all the other people in the world that are not believers, is the presence of God in our life. And that's what should distinguish us and should set us apart and to make us recognizable, is that the presence of God is in our life. And so it is important. And David, another characteristic is David understood that obedience is better than sacrifice. And in Psalms 119, 33 and 34, he says this, "Teach me, O Lord, the way of your statutes, and I shall observe it to the end. Give me understanding that I may observe your law and keep it with all my heart." And then again in Psalm 51, "For you do not delight in sacrifice, otherwise I would give it. You are not pleased with burnt offering. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart, O God, you will not despise." So, you know, and we've all heard that, you know, obedience is better than sacrifice. Well, I was thinking about it, and we can give a sacrifice or an offering and still be disconnected from God. In other words, we can come to church, which is a sacrifice, and not necessarily be connected to God. I mean, we can just check the box. Yeah, we came to church. Or yes, I did my little devotional. But obedience to his word, on the other hand, requires a decision. It involves the heart, because we have to choose to be obedient. We choose to live for Christ. We choose to allow him to expose and to bring up things that are hidden in our heart that we may not even be aware of. But if we're tender to him, then he begins to expose those things and bring them out into the light so that we can deal with them. David's faith in God was real. This is the fifth and last character quality of David that we're going to look at. His faith was real, and he trusted him completely. And there's no better exemplified, this is no better exemplified than his encounter with Goliath. The men of Israel feared Goliath. And in fact, every day, the armies of Saul were on this mountain, and the Philistine army was over here, and there was a valley kind of between them. And every day that the Goliath would come out there, and he would stand before them and challenge them. And the men just kind of held back and were just really afraid and fearful of the giant Philistine. And so let's look at that just quickly here. And that is found in 1 Samuel 16 or 17. Now, I was supposed to have this marked in my Bible. There it is. There. That's what these things are for. And I did have it marked. I just kind of forgot about it. Anyway, Jesse, and this was not long after Samuel anointed him to be king, that his dad Jesse, because David had three older brothers that were in the King Saul's army, and so Jesse sent David with some food for them, and so he saw Goliath, and you know, this was his response. "Who is this uncircumcised Philistine that he should taunt the armies of the living God. Now keep in mind that he was but a youth. And in my mind, I was actually going to do a visual here. And I'll tell you, I didn't tell the first service this, but I was going to get Tyler. I think he was maybe about 3 foot tall, because obviously we don't have anybody that's as tall as a giant, so I was going to recalculate it, you know. And so there was going to be Tyler here, who was 3 foot, and I figured maybe Doug on his knees would be 4 foot. And then Ryan would be here about 6 foot, or close to it. You know, you have to give a little bit. Ryan would be David. Doug would be Shaquille O'Neal, because we all know who Shaquille O'Neal is, and he's a massive man. And then Ryan would be Goliath, because according to Scripture, Goliath was 6 cubits tall, and a cubit is 18 inches, according to my footnote there. So that means he's 9 foot tall. So he's actually almost 2 foot taller than Shaquille O'Neal. And not only just height, but you would be intimidated by the size of Shaquille O'Neal if he walked through that doorway right there. There is no question in my mind. And I was just doing this just to illustrate that so you have Tyler against Ryan. And what a massive difference. So, it just amazes me that David had that kind of faith. The Lord, but see, David had, he was a shepherd's boy, and he spent a lot of time out in the fields just, you know, meditating on the Word of God and the laws of God and the statutes of God. And that's what built his faith. It's just like us, you know. Faith cometh by hearing, hearing by the Word of God. The more we absorb this Word, the more faith that we will attain. And he said, "The Lord who delivered me from the hand of the lion and from the paw of the lion and from the paw of the bear, he will deliver me from the hand of this Philistine." And then he gave the reason why. "That all the earth may know that there is a God in Israel, and that all this assembly may know that the Lord does not deliver by sword or by spear. For the battle is the Lord's, and he will give you into our hands." So he recognized that the battle was the Lord's, that it wasn't him, and that it wasn't his own strength that he was relying on, but he had faith in Almighty God. And, you know, there are a lot of giants in our life. We need faith and trust like David when we face the giants in our life. The giant of fear, the giant of doubt, the giant of addiction, the giant of an impure thought life, the giant of despair and hopelessness, the giant of sickness, or whatever giant you have in your life. For too long, we have told God how big the giants are in our life. Maybe we need to be more like David and tell the giant how big our God is. The battle is the Lord's, and he goes before us to fight our battles if we just give it to him. And the Israelites wandered in the desert for 40 years and failed to enter the promised land because of an unbelieving heart and disobedience to the Lord. Now, there's some symbolism in that passage, in that the promised land for the Israelites was a physical place that they were going to. And they failed to enter that promised land because of unbelief. They didn't believe that God could take them there. And so they never lived up to their destiny, that God had so much in store for them. Can you imagine that if they would have just believed? I mean, we wouldn't have that 40 years in the Bible. I mean, if they had just crossed the Red Sea and just marched right in and took the land like God had promised them he would do. They chose to believe the 10 negative stories of the spies rather than the two that believed. Yes, there are giants in the land, and yes, their fortified cities are real, but so is our God, and he is going to go before us, and we will conquer them. But they didn't choose to believe that. They chose to believe the giants are too big, the cities are too fortified. And I think sometimes isn't that the way we are? It's like, well, the giants are too big in our life. We can't do this. And true, on our own, we can't. But with God, all things are possible. And so, what did they sacrifice because of that decision? They sacrificed living out their destiny that God had for them. They never entered the place God had destined for them to experience, a place of rest and peace. And for us, that promised land is completely surrendering our life to God. And then we enter the promised land, so to speak, because we can rest from our works. We can rest from our efforts. We can rest from our own goodness to try and be good enough, because we can't be. And yet, we try sometimes, I think. We, as a people, are confronted with the same choice every time. We hear the word proclaimed, but it says there, back in that, also in Hebrews there, in that same passage, it says this, and I'm about to finish, so. For indeed we have had good news preached to us, just as they also, but the word they heard did not profit them, because it was not united by faith in those who heard. So they had a faith issue. They chose not to believe what the promise was. And it's that way with us. We make a choice. We choose to believe. And then we just, by faith, we just believe. I mean, that's the way it is when we come to Christ. You know, there's no way around it. You know, we can't see God, we can't touch God, but we can have the evidence that God is present. But there comes a point, a place, where we have to simply say, by faith, I receive you. I believe that you died on the cross for me, that you rose from the dead, and that I want you to be Lord of my life, and I receive that gift, that free gift, by faith. And so faith is so vital, so important to our life, that this scripture best describes that. For whatever is born of God overcomes the world, and this is the victory that overcomes the world, our faith. It is our faith that brings us victory in our life. So maybe this message the Lord has prompted you to ask one of these questions. Do I love God with all of my heart, soul, and mind? Do I love God more than anything or anyone? Is Jesus truly Lord of my life? Does he have all my heart today? Because remember, if he has all of our heart, he truly has us. Is there something he is asking me to surrender to him? Do I have an evil, unbelieving heart? Remember, one of the jobs of the Holy Spirit is to convict us of sin in our life. But it is always done in love. And because of love, he disciplines us and for our own benefit, transforming us into the likeness of the one we were created to be like. We were created in his likeness and image, and we should make as our ambition, our goal in life, to become more and more like the person that we were created to be like. And we can only do that if we make him Lord of our life and we surrender. If he speaks something to us in the Word and it says whatever, if I say and I'm honest with God and say, Lord, I know that's an area that I struggle with. Would you please help me? Then he will. He will help you. Keep in mind that he convicts, but he doesn't condemn. If you're feeling any kind of condemnation, I can assure you that that's not from God, because that's not the way God operates. In fact, the Bible says that there is no condemnation for those that are in Christ Jesus. So if you're feeling condemnation, it's not from God. But if you're feeling conviction, it could be. It well could be. Because that's what he does. He comforts us. He teaches us. He has all those qualities that are present in the Holy Spirit. But one of them is he convicts us of areas that we need work on and areas that he needs to move in our life and so that we will be more fully able to love, serve, and disciple other people. And that's the ultimate goal for the Holy Spirit's work in our life. Let's just bow our hearts in prayer. Father, we do thank you. Lord, just quiet our hearts once again, Lord, that we might stop and listen for your voice speaking to us. And Father, I pray that your will would be done in each and every heart, including mine, Father. For I know that there are areas that you are continuing to work out of me, and I thank you for that. I thank you that you love us enough that you sometimes point out areas in our life that are not pleasing to you. And so, Father, we ask that you would do what only you can do by your work, by the Holy Spirit. Lord, no man can change a heart, but you can change it instantly. You can create a new heart. And Father, I pray that if there is anyone here or listening online that has not received you as Christ, I pray, Father, that you would use this time to let them know that you love them beyond anything that they can ever even conceive or imagine. And Father, that you love them enough to send your Son to die on a cross for their sins. And I pray that this would be the day that they would be made new in Christ. For the Bible says today is the day of salvation. And Father, there are no guarantees for tomorrow, as many of us in this place know, Lord, that life can end in a short time. And Father, I just pray that you would continue to refine us and to work in us, Lord, and that we would allow you to do that work in our hearts. And I ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Well, thank you, Terry, for that message. And would you please stand and join us? Remember, you are so loved. Have a great week.
If you've been walking the same old road for miles and miles, if you've been hearing the same old voice at the same old lies, if you're trying to fill the same old holes inside, there's a better life. There's a better life. If you got pain, he's a pain taker. If you feel lost, he's a way maker. If you need freedom, a saving, he's a prison shaking savior. If you got chains, he's a chain breaker. We've all served.